There's a sermon illustration in that. My name is Beth Givens, and I'm the pastor here at Haygood, and I am delighted to welcome you to worship this day, both in person and online here at Haygood. If this is your first time with us today, we would encourage you to find the connect cards that are in the pew racks in front of you, to use those to let us know that you're here today, tell us a little bit about you. You can either write on them and place them in the offering bowl that's out in the lobby, or you can scan the QR code that's on them to complete our Connect form. We'd love to use them to learn a little bit about you and let you learn a little bit about us. Everyone can find out more about what's happening at Haygood in materials that are available out in our lobby, including our weekly email, The Beacon, and you can depend on our website as well, haygoodumcvb.org. The Appalachia Service Project mission team is raising money by selling subs and dessert charcuterie boards for the Super Bowl. What's a dessert charcuterie board? I have heard several people ask Christy Ferris this question. So a dessert board with Rice Krispie treats and cookies and cake pops and brownies, all in, you know, football-themed shapes and sizes. So that fills your imagination now, so you should go on and order one right now. The order form is online. You can find the links in the beacon or in handouts that are in the lobby. If you don't do online ordering, you can speak to Christy Ferris. Christy's here today. Will you raise your hand, Christy, so folks can see where you are? And she, I'm sure, will be delighted to help you. Tickets are on sale now for our Life School Musical Children's Dinner Theater on the evening of Friday, February 10th. For more information, see The Beacon or speak with Lori Miklachik or Marie Porter. They'll be glad to fill you in. This is a fundraiser for HARC, our local home repair ministry, and I hear a rumor that dinner is Clint Porter's meatloaf. Today, I heard that. Today, we continue a worship series called Intentional Influencers. For the next several weeks, we're going to be exploring how to be influencers in our community, how to love those who are outside of our walls and love them so much that they want to be a part of the Jesus movement here at Haygood. As we move into our time of worship, I invite you to take a couple of deep breaths and just center yourself in this space to let go of anything that's on your mind and on your heart. Just exhale and release that to God and breathe in God's Holy Spirit, who is here and waiting for our worship.
I invite you to stand as you're able and join me in the responsive invitation to worship. We gather in the name of the living Christ to worship God.
Surely God is in this place and calls us to worship in spirit and in truth.
God's love is for you, for all people, everywhere.
That we may share God's love and life. And life.
The living Christ is with us.
Praise the Lord.
Please remain standing as we sing our praises. Be Thou My Vision, 451 in the hymnal if you need it.
Thank you.
seated. We invite Miss Lori to come forward to share a message with the children.
Today. Oh, I'm so glad you all are doing good. So one of the things that we do a whole lot here in church, we do it every Sunday, is pray, right? We do a lot of praying in here. You guys pray with me, you probably pray with Miss Sarah, Pastor Beth prays. We do a lot of praying. Why do we do so much praying? It's a great way for us to talk to God. That's exactly right. And we only talk about ourselves, right? No. We talk about other people, though we want to be safe or saved, or that we want to bless. You're exactly right. When we're praying, we're not just praying for ourselves. We're praying for other people, too. Of course you can pray for yourself. Yes, yes, if you're sick or something, you can definitely pray for yourself. In our scripture today, we hear about Hannah who prays and prays and prays to God for someone. And you know what? God answered her prayer. And she blesses her with a son named Samuel. And is God still answering our prayers today?
Yes.
Now, it's not like I pray for a cookie to appear in my hand and that cookie's going to appear, right?
No.
God answers prayers in all different kinds of ways. Not always ways that we can see them. But it's important that we're praying for ourselves and for other people. It's our time that we're talking to God. And we only pray to him once and then we're done, right? We say the prayer once and that's it. No. How much are we supposed to pray? A lot? Ask him a whole lot of times? 1,000 times? That's a lot of times to ask. But you know, the Bible tells us that we should pray and pray intensely, which means a whole lot, for other people. It's important in our Christian relationship with others and with God that we are continually asking for God's prayers and blessings on other people. So this week when you guys are praying, okay, whether you're praying at home or praying here, I want you to include someone new in your prayer that you haven't prayed for yet. Do you think you guys can do that?
Yeah.
Maybe like the kid that's being mean to you at school, that's a great person to pray for. I know, it's kind of crazy, but you can pray for them. Or maybe there's a neighbor that you want to pray for that you've never prayed for. I want you guys to add one person to your prayer this week and pray for them every single day. You think we can do that? Every day you pray for different people already? That's awesome. So let's go ahead and continue that trend. Do you think our congregation can pray for someone new this week? I think they can too, and our friends online as well. But we have to remind them, we got to do it every day because we're going to pray intensely for someone, right? Just like Jesus taught us. So let's go ahead and turn to God in prayer now. Who should be our person that we're going to add to pray for this week? Who do you think we should pray for in our prayer? Our community around us? Okay, we're going to add them to our prayer. So that's going to be the one I'll be using all week long. You're welcome to share too, Haygood, or pick someone else. So let's go ahead and turn to God in prayer now. Let's fold our hands and bow our heads and repeat after me, and congregation, repeat after me too. Dear God,
dear God,
thank you so much, for hearing our prayers, and for answering them.
Help us
to always turn to you,
and to pray intensely
for all those in the world. We lift up today
our Haygood community
and ask your blessings
upon it.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Okay, parents, we're going to head down the hall to Children's Church and you'll pick up down our Children's Hall.
Today's reading comes from the Old Testament with selected verses from 1 Samuel chapters 1 and 2. Whenever he sacrificed, Elkanah would give parts of the sacrifice to his wife, Penina, and to all of her sons and daughters. But he would only give one part to Hannah. Though he loved her, it's because the Lord had kept her from conceiving. And because the Lord had kept Hannah from conceiving, her rivals would make fun of her mercilessly, just to bother her. One time, after eating and drinking at the temple, Hannah got up and presented herself before the Lord. Now Eli was the priest that was sitting in the chair by the doorpost of the Lord's temple. Hannah was very upset and couldn't stop crying as she prayed to the Lord. Then she made this promise, "Lord of heavenly forces, just look at your servant's pain and remember me. Don't forget your servant. Give her a boy. Then I'll give him to the Lord for his entire life. No razor will ever touch his head." So in the course of time, Hannah conceived and gave birth to a son. She named him Samuel, which means, "I asked the Lord for him." When he had been weaned and was still very young, Hannah took him along with the sacrifice and brought him to the Lord's house at Shiloh. They slaughtered the bull and then brought the boy to Eli. "Excuse me, sir," Hannah said. "As surely as you live, sir, I am the woman who stood here next to you praying to the Lord. I prayed for this boy, and the Lord gave me what I asked from him. So now I give this boy back to the Lord. As long as he lives, he is given to the Lord." Then Hannah prayed, "My heart rejoices in the Lord. My strength rises up in the Lord. My mouth mocks my enemies because I rejoice in your deliverance. No one is holy like the Lord. No one except you. There is no rock like our God. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God.
Will you join your hearts with mine in prayer? Come, Holy Spirit, and add your presence and your blessing to these words that Mike has read, to these words that I now speak, to the thoughts that will move through our minds and the emotions that will move through our spirits. Send your Holy Spirit that these would be your words, your thoughts, your feelings, and that they might transform us to look more like Christ. Amen. Let me begin this morning by naming that the story of Hannah is both beautiful and terrible. It is a beautiful story about the power of intense prayer, which is where we will focus today. It's also terrible because it is a difficult passage in Scripture amidst the reality that I know of couples who struggle with infertility, what the Bible calls barrenness. It is an exquisitely personal struggle. And even for those who are the most open about it, talking about it carries a measure of pain. And I know that that's a tender, difficult subject for many people. So let me be clear. I don't believe we worship a God who capriciously chooses to open the wombs of some and not of others, simply because they pray a very earnest prayer. That simplifies not only who God is, but who we are. My calling would be a lot easier if I could say, like Miss Lori just suggested, "Please, God, give me a cookie." If I could say to people, "Here, go pray a prayer like Hannah's and God will answer you." But I can't say that. What I can say is we are supposed to pour our hearts out to God in prayer. That kind of prayer in and of itself can be healing for us. And we also live in a world that is flawed and imperfect. And sometimes, many times, in fact, God's answers to the ways that we pour out our hearts are not what we think we want or need. Our wants and needs get all tangled up in the imperfections of this world. However, in the end, God always moves toward love. God's promise is fundamentally to love us with a love greater than we can fully comprehend, and to invite us to live into that love by loving others. Hannah received God's love in the form of a child, and she lived into that promise by giving her child back to God. She takes him to the temple to live for his whole life, just after he is weaned, and he grows up to play an instrumental role in the story of God's people. Her son's name is Samuel. He will anoint King Saul and then King David as kings over Israel. In other words, as Marcia Mount Shoup writes, the monarchy is born out of barrenness, anguish, and uninhibited entanglement with God's faithfulness. The establishment of the monarchy was one of the significant ways that God acted to bring peace to the people of Israel. And as we think about how it is that God is inviting us to be a part of influencing our community in the ways of peace, monarchy is not the answer, but perhaps we can look at the origins of the monarchy for some answers. Specifically, perhaps we can identify with Hannah's incredible faith despite her anguish and suffering. Perhaps we can look at her as a model of deep and faithful prayer that invites God's transformation. Another model of deep and faithful prayer that invites transformation comes to us from Susanna Wesley, the mother of John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement. As Chris Ritter relates, around the year 1700, Susanna developed the custom of gathering her whole household together in the kitchen on Sunday nights to read a printed sermon and join in the service of evening prayer from the Book of Common Prayer. I should note that Susanna and her husband Samuel had 19 children, so this was not a small gathering. Neighbors began to join these gatherings. And at one point, when her husband Samuel was on an extended leave to London, he left the church that he was pastoring then in the less than capable hands of a substitute priest. Now, Susanna's prayer meetings were drawing such a large crowd, about 200 people, that the substitute assistant wrote complaining to Samuel that she was drawing a bigger crowd in her kitchen on Sunday night than he was on Sunday morning. Samuel wrote to his wife, Susanna, suggesting that she should perhaps dissolve the meeting. And Susanna wrote back to Samuel and said, and this is a direct quote from Wesley's diary, "If you do, after all, think it fit to dissolve this assembly, do not tell me merely that you desire me to do it, for that will not satisfy my conscience. But send me your positive command in such full and express terms as may absolve me from all guilt and punishment for neglecting this opportunity of doing good when you and I shall appear before the great and awful tribunal of our Lord Jesus Christ."
She was in charge.
The Sunday evening prayer meetings continued. As we continue to think about how to be intentional influencers in our community, we need to engage this question of how to pray for our community, how to pray like Hannah, how to pray like Susanna. 2 weeks ago on January 16th, when we shared in the prayer journey, the peace journey on Martin Luther King Day, the folks who gathered, who were from several different congregations in our community, as well as Virginia Wesleyan University, lifted up these prayer concerns as we stopped and prayed at various places in our community. We talked about residents of senior living facilities who faced such deep loneliness during the pandemic and continue to struggle with isolation and loneliness, all the while being a source of deep wisdom for emerging generations. We talked and prayed about college students moving into adulthood and learning all the things that come with adulting while facing an unprecedented wave of mental health challenges. Specifically, we prayed about students learning to develop and young adults learning to develop generative adult friendships, learning to handle things on their own that their parents might have handled for them up until now, and facing new temptations. We talked about and we prayed for small business owners who fought to survive during the pandemic and now face rising rent and other inflation costs. These businesses offer important services to the community, like dry cleaning, accounting, personal care, restaurants, and so much more. We talked about and prayed over small businesses and residents impacted by the illegal drug trade that leads to violence in our communities. We talked and prayed about the people in our communities whose life circumstances lead them to use or trade in illegal substances. We talked about and prayed for and with Virginia Beach police officers trying to combat the illegal drug trade, personal property theft, and other crimes and the violence to which they sometimes lead. We talked about and prayed for students in our schools facing bullying, pressures to achieve, learning challenges, and so much more. We talked and prayed about teachers and staff and administrators in our schools who are challenged by pandemic setbacks, the general task of education, and an atmosphere with significant safety concerns. And after experiencing that prayer journey 2 weeks ago, I've been pondering the question, how can we be like Hannah, like Susanna Wesley, like so many throughout history who have brought the kind of prayer that is transformative to bear on the immense challenges of this world? I do know that prayer without a relationship is not genuine. In other words, praying for our community without also taking clear steps to get to know our community, that's not faithful. But if we are serious about being intentional influencers in this community, then we need to be equally intentional about our prayer. We need to have the faithfulness of Hannah to pray even though an answer seems impossible. Then we need to have her faithfulness to follow through with our prayers even when the consequences of them are challenging. If we pray for any one of these groups that I've named in our community, if we seriously and intensely pray for them, it might be that God's response to our prayer is to ask us to act, to do something, to be Christ's hands in the midst of the situation. Through our prayer, we might be called to visit senior living centers and develop relationships, to befriend drug traffickers, to tutor in our schools, or other things we cannot even yet imagine. Prayer is powerful, my friends. If we take it seriously, it invites us into a deeper relationship with the suffering of the world, and then it compels us to Christ-like actions in the midst of that suffering. Prayer is also powerful because we do not know where it leads. In fact, it's really not faithful to ask God to solve a problem and assume that we know what the answer is going to be. Hannah, when she began to pour herself out to God, had no idea what the end result would be. She was simply very upset and began pouring all of those feelings and emotions out to the Lord. The suffering of this community should upset us. It should shake us to our core. It should call us to urgent, sustained prayer, first for our community, but second for our ministry in the midst of that community. Where will those prayers lead us? Who among us is ready, is called to invest in intense prayer for our community? And what might that look like? These are the invitations that I believe God is extending to us. May God raise up among us those who will lead our response. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to join in responding to God's word by singing our response, number 496, Sweet Hour of Prayer, in our hymnals. Will you stand as you're able? As we think about the ways that our gifts make a difference, we are in a season of starting new small group ministries here at Haygood. We have a board game group, a Sunday brunch group, a Caring for Caregivers group, and a Sunday morning 9:30 Bible study. Small groups are a wonderful way for you to connect with others around shared experiences or study and be able to support one another in relationships that develop in those smaller settings. All of our small groups are made possible by the gifts that you give to Haygood. This is one way that your gifts make a difference. You may give online by placing an offering in the bowl that is in the middle of our lobby or by mailing a check to the church. As we think this day about the joys and concerns of our congregation, as we prepare to turn to God in prayer, I want to lift up George Phillips and Laverne Kingsley, who've been hospitalized this week. George has gone to Lake Taylor for rehab, and we want to keep them in our prayers. Laverne hopes to go to rehab early this week. We have learned this week of the deaths of Haygood members David Bertelson and James Baker and want to keep their families in our prayers. Today is Patty Liebler's birthday, and one way that God has answered prayer in our community is through healing and hope for her husband, her widower, Butch. And so we give thanks for that, the way that God has moved in him. We also want to pray for another specific prayer concern in our community, Christ Presbyterian Church, which is at the corner of Aragona and Witch Duck. Has experienced vandalism over a period of several months. They've also had a large tree fall on part of their facility. I've been in touch with their pastor and have connected them with our Hark ministry and have offered some assistance, but we need to pray for that community and where God might be leading us to offer assistance, but also for those who are vandalizing the church, which circles us back to some of the things that I mentioned in my sermon. As we prepare to turn to God in prayer, our choir prepares us. Prepare to turn to God in prayer. One other note that I was led to through the way that you just prayed for us, which is that you will see me often as I pray doing this. And some years ago, I moved from praying like this to praying like this, because this is very closed and focused on me. this is open and lets me hear God. One's not better than the other. But I simply explain why you see me doing this and invite you, if you are led, to do the same. Let us turn to God in prayer. Creating God, your children are praying. We live and move in your love, and we pray for a world crying out to know that love. For all your children around the globe who want to feel, who deserve to feel loved and wanted and cherished and unique. We pray for a world torn apart by conflict and war. For mass shootings in California, violence in Israel, for the reckoning of violence in Memphis. We pray for a world that lives uneasily in a climate of fear with a cloudy vision for the future. We pray for a world that thinks of others less than we think of ourselves. A world where division between nation and race and religion and neighbor and family leads to distrust. We pray for our community, O Lord, where people are short on happiness and hard on luck and can turn to drugs and violence and just misbehaving to fill the void. We pray for our community where law enforcement wants to protect people and keep the peace, and people are led into paths of wrongdoing that alter their lives forever. We pray for our schools, preschool, elementary, middle, high schools, colleges, full of students, some of whom are eager to learn and some of whom don't see the point. We pray for the outcast and the bully, for the athlete and the artist, for all to find their place. We pray for older adults in our community, especially those who are alone and isolated and feel like the world has passed them by. Help us learn from their wisdom and their lived experience. Within our fellowship, we pray specifically for the families of James Baker and David Bertelson who grieve. Pray for healing for Laverne and George, Candace and Victoria. We pray for Christ Presbyterian Church, for its leaders, for its members, for its pastor. We pray for Butch and give you thanks for the healing in his life. Oh God, we pray for our church in the midst of this community and this world. We know you are calling us, oh Lord. We are here in this community at this time for a reason. Pour out your spirit upon us so we might be bold enough to seek it, have eyes to behold it, and a deep faith to live it. All by the power of your Spirit at work in us, as we follow our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'll invite you to stand as you're able as we sing our commitment number 397 in our hymnals, I Need Thee, Oh, I Need Thee.
Thank you.
need thee every hour. Teach us thy will and thy rich promises in us fulfill. 1872, that hymn was written. And still today, God's people say, we need thee every hour so that we might know God's will and purpose in our lives and in our community. May we go from this place to seek God and to find God. Because we pray, in spite of our prayers, through our lives. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon you and live through you this day and always. And all God's people said,
Amen.